Well, welcome everybody. Welcome to the third installment of Pathways to Ethical Culture. My name is Richard Koral, and Joe Chuman and I are two of the leaders at the New York Society for Ethical Culture, and I am also part-time leader at the Long Island Society, and some of our Long Island people are here today, which is really great. Today, in our continuing story of the philosophical background of ethical culture, Joe is going to introduce the basically the final part of his series on Felix Adler's development to the mature views that he had and he took into the ethical culture movement. And the ethical culture movement evolved over the years and moved actually beyond, in some ways, Adler's own views. And so I will attempt to give a little bit of a picture of the modern view. So I have to say that we're really well endowed tonight. We have two philosophy professors here, not only Joe, but also David Sprinson, who is basically an expert on this subject. So I invite David to correct me when I say silly things, unless they're funny. So if they're funny, then just keep it. So I just want to say the New York Society for Ethical Culture, if I think most of the people here are really familiar with it, but it's the original ethical culture society, almost 150 years old, and it's been on West 64th Street for 110 years, and welcomes visitors every Sunday at 11 o'clock. We have our Sunday program, and we have all kinds of other activities, which I hope you can explore by looking through our website and coming around and joining us. And it's a nice community of folks. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to pass the baton over to Joe and stand back.
Okay, very good. Let me start off by saying that our third session tonight is really dedicated to talking about a transition in ethical culture in terms of its implicit philosophy. To a great extent, the philosophy of ethical culture has been shaped by its professional leaders. And for the first 50 years, that shape was most influenced by the thought of our founder, Dr. Felix Adler, who is, I would argue, the only serious philosopher, true philosopher that we've had in leadership. We've had a lot of smart people with a diversification of interests, but in terms of full-time leadership, Adler was really, I think, far and away the most pronounced philosopher. Let me just say a few things, though. He taught in the academy for 2 years in the early 20th century. He taught full time at Columbia teaching political and social ethics. And then for the remainder of his career, from about 1903 until he died in 1933, he was, for lack of a better term, an adjunct who taught graduate courses in questions of philosophy and primarily ethics. He was extremely bright. He got his PhD at the University of Heidelberg in Germany. He was born in Germany and came over when he was 7 years old with his family. And Heidelberg was probably the best university in the world at the time. The German universities had really the reputation for being free, free of ecclesiastical influence. All of American colleges up until the 1850s were really founded by churches, including my own Columbia University, which was founded by Episcopals, Episcopalians, and Princeton by Presbyterians, and so forth. But the German universities had a reputation for being the freest and the best. And it's there that Adler studied for his doctorate and got his PhD when he was 22 years old. So he was not a great undergraduate student. He went to Columbia College, was not a sterling student then, but really shined in his graduate work at Heidelberg and came back and then taught for a few years in the early 1870s at Cornell, He taught Oriental languages and what was known as the higher criticism of the Bible, which was using contemporary techniques to look at the origins of the Bible, and taught there for 3 years, and then came back to lead the Ethical Society. I should say that although he was, I would say he was brilliant, he did not leave an enduring mark on American philosophy. Among philosophers, he's really an effective footnote to American philosophy, cited occasionally in footnotes. But he had no philosophical disciples. He had, acolytes and disciples in the ethical movement as ethical leaders, but academically, he did not. And although he was a prodigious writer, Columbia University has his archives, the major bulk of his archives, and the introduction to the index indicates that there are 17,000 pieces of writing by Felix Adler that Columbia has. Now, some of them just may have been notes or letters, but he was a prodigious writer, yet oddly enough, published only 2 books in his lifetime. One was a book on the moral instruction of children, and the other was his magnum opus, where he lays out his philosophy and ethical philosophy of life, and so on. The other books by Adler are really compilations of talks and whatever put together by other people, not that he himself had put them together as texts. Let me just say philosophically that Adler, and this influenced ethical culture's philosophy for the first 50 years or so, Adler was what we call a philosophical idealist, which is a branch of philosophy that flourished in the 19th century. It was probably the regnant, most prominent philosophy in Europe in the 19th century, but flourished most of all among Germans. The German philosophers had a type of intuitive feel for idealism, which can mean several things, but one, as I explained last month, is that ideals are really real, that ideals are more real than material substances. Material substances are transient. They come to an existence, they come into existence and then fade away. But ideals are eternal. Think the Pythagorean theorem. I would often like to sort of challenge my students and say, well, did the Pythagorean theorem exist before Pythagoras thought it up? And the answer is yes. Did the Pythagorean theorem exist before there were human beings in the age of the dinosaurs? Well, in some sense, we could just say it did, right? Did it exist at the moment of creation, the Big Bang? We might say, yes, the Pythagorean theorem did as well. So the Pythagorean theorem as an idea is everlasting. You, I, and your laptop came into existence at a particular identified time. You age, it ages, and it will pass from the scene. So idealists hold to the notion that ideals, as Plato, the original idealist, ideals are really real, okay, and things of matter are less real in a certain sense. And Adler adhered, as did many Germans, to idealism. The great German idealist of the late 18th century, of which Adler was a type of disciple, was Immanuel Kant. And Adler's thought remained broadly Kantian throughout his career. Another great German idealist, of course, was Friedrich Hegel. Okay, Friedrich Hegel. And Karl Marx used to like to say that he stood Hegel on its head, and out of Hegel's dialectic created historical materialism and so forth. But the Germans were again rooted for the most part in idealism. The British, by contrast, stereotypically were known to be empiricists, that is to look at philosophy from the point of view of the experience that we get through our senses rather than the ideals that we logically construct or intuitively sense. So Adler was of that ilk, and as I mentioned last time, he tried to solve the problem of proving, to his mind at least, if it's to nobody else's, that the worth and dignity of the human being was absolute. This in a world in the Industrial Revolution when people were being abused and oppressed all the time, lived in tenements and in slums and were chained to their machines in their factories, and their humanity was really debased and oppressed at all times. And Adler felt a need to prove that despite the realities that the human being is worthy, and he looked to his idealism to create the foundations for an absolute conviction that the human being was indeed worthy. And that philosophy really framed his ethical culture. I won't get into it again because I'm repeating myself, but out of his idealism, he created a spiritual universe, which he called the organic ideal, or the supreme ethical ideal, or the supra ideal, and very often referred to by the ungainly sort of wonky term, the ethical, supreme ethical, organic ethical manifold. Manifold meaning having many parts. Okay. And he believed that this world is not all that there is, that there is the world of idea and ideals in the form of this manifold that is made up of an infinite number of members that are all conjoined together in an organic reciprocal relationship, so that any action by any one member, meaning us spiritually, basically affects every other member and the entire organic spiritual body. And so when we bring out the best in others, we organically set in motion a reciprocal action to bring out the best in ourselves. That was, in a nutshell, Adler's idealism and ethical ideals. Now, I should say, and I want to make this very specific, speak specifically in terms of ethical culture as an institution. Adler founded the ethical culture movement as a religio-philosophical movement, and he thought he was doing something religious, in 1876. And he made it very clear that as long as people were committed to the supremacy of ethics and strove to live an ethical life, they could come to their ethics by any personal belief or creed that they might have. Okay, they could be Hegelians, they could be materialists, they could be atheists, they could be humanists, they could be Jews, Christians, or whatever, as long as they arrived at a common conviction about the importance, the salience of living an ethical life. However, Adler himself, this is interesting, I was speaking to Richard earlier today, when Adler was asked, is ethical culture your religion? Adler's response was, no, it is not my religion. My religion is what he called ethical religion. He had his own personal idealistic philosophy that it was expressive of this manifold, this ethical ideal that I've mentioned, and that was his personal belief. And he preached from it, especially for the second half of his career from the 1890s. Most of his platform addresses, and I've met a lot of them, if you decode them, you can see the template or the format of the ethical ideal behind them, with regard to whatever social problem or issue he was talking about. And that remained his own personal philosophy. He did not require members to believe in the ethical manifold or to believe in ethical religion or to hold any particular idea or series of ideas in mind in order to be an ethical culturist. There was no creedal requirement, even though he himself very much had his own philosophical creed. But what's very interesting, I did tell Richard about this earlier, he was responsible for training subsequent ethical leaders during his career. The ethical culture training program was Felix Adler with his acolytes at his feet, and he had provided them with lots of erudite seminars, and he insisted, despite his open-mindedness about ethical culture when it came to the membership, he required that the leaders of ethical culture be ethical idealists. They had to hold to his metaphysical idealistic view in order to pass muster to become leaders. So in that sense, he was rather, to use the word dogmatic is strong, but he had his own convictions as to what he wanted ethical leaders to be and what he wanted them to preach, even as the movement was open to its members from all types of beliefs. Now, during his time, he attracted a lot of Germans and German Jews to the congregation, and being of German origin, in effect, they too had this type of idealistic, rationalistic, almost otherworldly sensibility. Okay, I don't want to mislead, but almost a quasi-mystical sort of sensibility. This was typical of high-minded, intellectual, well-educated Germans, many of whom were provided the mainstay of the New York Society for Ethical Culture in its earliest decades. That changed, and it's my theory, and this is mine alone, that the philosophy of ethical culture began to move away from Adler's idealism for several reasons. The first was that it was a European philosophy, and I contend that Adler was a 19th century figure and backward looking in terms of his philosophy. Idealism did not make a great mark philosophically on the American scene with regard to academics. There were a few idealists, such as the philosopher Josiah Royce, who taught at Harvard and at Berkeley for many years, but they were fairly few. What happened in America in the early decades of the 20th century, was the emergence of naturalism and pragmatism. Pragmatism gained a reputation of being the distinctive American philosophy, which was not rooted in ideals or absolutes, but basically rooted in experience, to make a long story short. And it produced certain luminaries who were the fathers of pragmatism in the United States. Among them was a fellow by the name of Charles Sanders Peirce. Was not very prolific, but he was really the originator of pragmatism. And his two great disciples, a bit different in their temperaments, was the great American philosopher and experimental psychologist and artist, William James. Okay, he was the older brother of the novelist Henry James, and William James taught at Harvard for many years and set up the first experimental lab in experimental psychology, and was a father of pragmatism, wrote essays on pragmatism and so forth, and perhaps superseding even James philosophically, slightly different temperament, was the greatest luminary of 20th century philosophy in America, maybe in the history of American philosophy, and that was John Dewey. John Dewey started his career at the University of Michigan, then taught at the University of Chicago, and then came to Columbia University, I guess in around 1910, and lived out the rest of his career at Columbia University, and was the luminary of philosophical naturalism. Okay, very different from Adler's idealism. Naturalism basically states that nature is all that there is, and there is nothing outside of nature. Adler certainly would not have held to that view. He felt there was something beyond the world of nature, impersonal, austerely impersonal, but this world was not all. There was the world of ideals, the world of spirit, and so on and so forth. So Dewey's naturalism became the regnant philosophy in the early decades of the 20th century, produced lots of acolytes and so forth. And the point that I'm leading to here is that Dewey's naturalism, and Richard will talk about this, this is an introduction to Richard here, that Dewey's naturalism really superseded Adler's idealism. The last thing I want to mention before we move on to talk about Dewey's naturalism and ethical culture is that part of the change, I think, from idealism to naturalism was not only that idealism reached a dead end in America and Felix Adler's philosophy was no longer, among academics, didn't have much traction any longer. It's that the demographics of the New York society changed. Germans and German Jews constituted the bulwark of the New York society when Adler founded it, but 1881 marks the beginning of the great waves of immigration from Southern and from Eastern Europe and so forth until the doors of immigration were closed in 1924. And in those waves of immigration, you had a huge influx of Eastern Europeans, including Eastern European Jews, several million of them. And they didn't come with the idealism of their German brethren, who, by the way, looked down on them because they were the great unwashed, the poor, and so forth. But they came with variations of philosophies of socialism, okay, Marxism, and liberalism, which in effect, and a good number of those people joined the New York Ethical Society. And I would argue it changed its demographic character. And with that change, the implicit philosophy, all this is implicit, the implicit philosophy of ethical culture really shifted from Adler's idealism to Dewey's naturalism. So for those two reasons, one intellectual and philosophical, the other one demographic. But here we are. If somebody asked us today, what is the implicit, not, we don't have an explicit creed, but we do have, every group has its own character. If someone were to ask us, what is the implicit philosophy of ethical culture these days, I think you could do no better than to say implicitly, we are Deweyan. that the philosophy of John Dewey has informed where ethical culture has ended up. Even if people are not philosophers, we still indeed adhere, I think, to a Deweyan sensibility and a Deweyan sense of values and how reality in the world are put together. So let me end with that and turn to my colleague, Richard. That was just by way of introduction. Okay, Richard, take it away.
Well, okay. So we can talk a little bit about John Dewey, but I want to step back a little bit and say I think that history of ethical culture is a little more complicated than just the experience in New York of Jewish immigration. I mean, there were major societies since the 1880s in Chicago and St. Louis and Philadelphia, which had different demographics. There were a lot more Midwestern. The leaders of those societies were not like Felix Adler, who studied for the rabbinate and whose father was a major Reform rabbi. The other five significant originating leaders all came from Protestant backgrounds of different kinds. One was evangelical, some were Unitarian. John Lovejoy Elliott really came from a secular family. So there was really a little bit more of a variety. But in New York, I would say that's definitely true about how the waves of immigration affected our New York society and our area. The shift to John Dewey was a gradual one, but the funny thing is that John Dewey and Felix Adler knew each other well. They were both at Columbia University, both in New York, both public figures, and there seemed to be some kind of implicit affection between them. They were friendly, and I understand that John Dewey came to the Ethical Society once or twice at a platform, I believe, and so there was this correspondence. Nevertheless, John Dewey had a very different approach towards the world, as Joe was saying. So who is John Dewey really quickly? He was a very accomplished academic as a psychologist. He became he was elected president of the American Psychological Association. As a philosopher, he was elected president of the American Philosophical Association. So he was a person of great influence. He wrote indefatigably. He wrote books, all of them extremely turgid and difficult to read unless you're a philosophy major. But he wrote on education and originated his own theories of what was called progressive education. Aesthetics, on democracy, on philosophy, in logic, on psychology, on religion, and of course on social issues of the day. He was a real activist in making himself, his opinions known for social issues and social movements of the day. He'd go out and demonstrate, you know, for teachers unionizing. I'm told he wasn't a great speaker. And one of the differences is the legacy they leave. John Dewey, of course, has a bookshelf of his works, and he was followed by many academics. But he also sketched out a kind of modern religion, a view of what a modern humanistic religion would be in his little book, A Common Faith. But he didn't create any organization. On the other hand, Felix Adler did not write so many books, but he was an organizational man, and he created these communities that were socially activist, that were engaged, and had histories, ups and downs, and were alive. So what was really the difference between them? And what did What did Dewey really introduce, and what was the American pragmatist view? Well, it was a much more a view less of the ideals that that are created outside of humans, and rather to say that our ethical rules are created out of our interactions, out of our experience, out of our perceptions here in the world. So he would one line over here I have in psychology, he tended away from the idea of somatic explanations for behavior that Joe, let me just, Joe, you hear me?
Yeah.
Your microphone keeps rubbing against your shirt and it makes a big noise. I know your relationship with microphones.
Yeah, I have trouble with mics. All
Okay, thank you. All
Yeah, okay,
right,
I'm
never
back
mind.
there. Okay, sorry about
Okay.
that.
There was as psychology was emerging as a science, and he was really at the forefront of the days of early experimental psychology. The question was, where did our behaviors emerge from? Was it out of the body experience? Was it built in, or was it out of our experience, nature versus nurture? He really expanded on the idea that it comes from the social context in which we live. Similarly, with our ethical concepts of our ideals, they emerge in the cultural context in which we grow up and we communicate with others. He had this word for it, he called it transactionalism. And transactionalism doesn't mean not an economic exchange with others, but we exchange ideas and we learn from each other in every respect. And we're created in this dynamic relationship with not only within our social milieu, our environmental milieu, and we learn from other individuals, of course. The history of language, is a perfect example. It's constantly evolving so that we communicate with each other. So it is with our attitudes and our mores. So, are there no absolutes? Are there real truths? In his book, A Common Faith, where he tries to sketch out the idea of a modern humanistic religion, he criticizes the original traditional religions by saying that they vary all over the world. They have different gods. They have different mythologies. Their supernatural powers that are attributed to their gods are different from one to another. And they can't all be right. So where does it come from? The revelations that they attribute them to can't be exact because they come to such different conclusions. So therefore, they must be historical, coming out of the social context of each culture. So each religion is inevitably a part of the culture out of which it emerges. So what do we do? Are we to be bound by these historical ruts that different communities find themselves in and carry on? So what he would say is that there is something that has sort of a natural piety, as he called it. So where is this natural piety? It is from our experience working in nature and in our community. The nature is as a unity of which we're a part, and we learn to deal with it. And insofar as we learn to deal with it, we are creating the patterns and the rules that serve our community. So the idea that of pragmatism is that, well, simply said, Pragmatism says the rule that we choose is the one that works. Or sometimes they say the one that is most satisfies the most people, that is the better idea. But it's a little bit more than that insofar as it comes from the myriad experiences of myriad interactions with people, among people, that we learn from in our current common experience. The best way to do something, the best way to be reciprocal, the best way to learn from others is from our common and continuous interactions among ourselves. And so we are creating these ethical rules. They're not discovered or they're not given to us, they emerge. He also has some other ideas that you would find familiar. You know, the idea that science is the means by which we learn how nature works through the scientific method, and that sort of undermines the answers that religion has been giving us. You know, so the more we learn through science, the smaller the mysteries tend to be. And, you know, that whole process is showing us that the traditional religions aren't really sufficing. So, with that kind of idea that that ethics is something that we are creating, then this is part of our creative engagement with the world to make a better world by seeing what is the way to do things, by having basically experiences of coming together. And you know, we were talking about the this is the 75th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So we've been looking at it, and I was looking, and it's a statement of values that is hopefully universal. Of course, it's also universally violated when we have all these wars, but it's still aspirational. And these kinds of conventions that we create emerge from our experience and our cooperation and our treatment with each other. So we really do create our world. We have choices. We can do things that are awful, but we can also do things that are good. And this kind of constant creativity means recognizes how much we value and are valued in the world. So what happened with ethical culture in dealing with this? The humanist movement, the movement with the name humanism, emerged in the 1920s. Outside of ethical culture, but ethical culture was already a non-theistic movement that was engaged with social action and social activism, and the two of them should have merged together. Felix Adler was very antagonistic towards the humanist movement. In 1933, a number of declared humanists created what they called the Humanist Manifesto in an effort to really write it, put it down in writing what this movement meant. And Felix Adler refused to sign it. That was the last year of his life. But he, as I understand it, forbade any of the other leaders in the ethical movement to sign it. John Dewey did sign it, and he did participate. I think Thayer signed it, didn't Joe? Do you know if Thayer
Yeah,
signed?
B.G. Thayer was the director of the Ethical Culture Schools, and he sort of
Yeah.
snuck behind Felix Adler and did
Yeah, that was,
sign,
I think.
right, the Humanist Manifesto, right?
So
He was
yeah,
not a leader
Thayer
in the
again
movement,
was,
but he was
he
affiliated.
was not an official leader, but he was in a leadership role, a very strong leadership role as head of the schools. But yeah, I remember that he did sign it. So that was a little rebellious action on the part of somebody. But later years, leaders in the ethical movement did participate. Now, there were a couple of revisions of the Humanist Manifesto, this 1973 version, which tried to account for all the big movements that were happening at the time, the civil rights movement, the feminist movement, the gay rights movement. And so they tried to incorporate all of those. It got a little bit unwieldy. And in 2003, a third Humanist Manifesto was created, which again was very simple and direct, a one-pager, and very nicely written. Ethical culture leaders signed on to the second in 73 and the third in 2003, and were part of that process. So, what was the change? The change happened officially in 1965, when this is now 20 years after Felix Adler's death. The leaders came together. Joseph Blau was kind of the rapporteur of this commission to actually try to see if they could blend and merge the idea of ethical culture as its history and the humanist movement. And the general feeling was that ethical culture really was a humanist movement, and it really was not realistic in trying to find distinctions because the commonality was so strong. And so those Blau Commission wrote a report saying that we really, really are humanist. And from that day, many of the societies changed their name, actually, from ethical culture societies to ethical humanist societies. Long Island did around that time, I think in 1973. Westchester did, but then they changed their name back. Today, a lot of, as new groups emerge, they have been adopting the name Ethical Humanist Society. And the American Ethical Union, the Federation, actually went and trademarked the name Ethical Humanist, so that when little small groups join or they drop out, the name Ethical Humanist, will still remain to be ours. And it is a unique name. It's unique to our movement. So if anyone wants a copy of the Humanist manifestos, you ask me. It's interesting reading. It's nice. It's good to see, in the simple language, the ideals that we do kind of share are really nicely laid out. And I can send you copies if anyone is interested. So that's it. I see we're 15 minutes before our official ending time. I think we could open up for questions, or if Joe, you have something more, or I would invite David, who can come and correct me for all the things I said wrong about John Dewey. But I made him out pretty well. He probably would like the portrait I gave him himself, right? Except about the turgid writing style. If someone has questions, or any kind of comment or any kind of concern. I see Maria has a hand up. Maria, unmute.
Just I want to say something that not only the ethical society but the world when to do it, scientists points of view. But now it's coming back to Adler because the people need idealism, a spirituality, to endure the reality, this is a fact, the people needs that. And the society has to contemplate these things. No, get stuck to the scientist's point of view, Because in reality, we need these two philosophies working together, scientists and idealists, because it's the only way to go to the future,
That's so interesting you say that, Maria. I think in our real world experience, that is very true. We in ethical culture say we don't have a theology. We don't have a required a set of beliefs, and people bring their beliefs with them. And part of it is, we are creating our own approach, and we are creating our own religion all the time. And we're free to modify it. We're not perfect, so our whole sense of reality is subject to revision, new thinking, and what is the most creative way to really approach life, life's issues, life's problems, is with a sense of an idealistic aspiration. I think you're right, that there is that sort of is an undercurrent in all the rationalist thinking that we have. Did some I see hands moving around. Frank and Kevin, did you have your hand up or no? Okay. Frank, unmute.
Thank you, Richard. That was really enlightening. I had a question about the role of looking at past traditions, philosophies that came in the past, religious insights of the various religions that came in the past. I understand John Dewey's emphasis on learning from experience and deriving values and ways of going forward. Derived out of social interactions and our own experience. But I'm wondering if you and or Joe could comment on the role of looking at the past to help us make decisions in the present and the future.
I'd ask Joe to make comment because he's the one who actually went ahead and got a PhD in religious studies at Columbia. So why does an ethical, a devoted ethical culturist study religion?
Well, okay, because I'm one of those atheists who's absolutely fascinated by religion. I come out of a religious background. I'm like a good number of ethical cultures, I'm not hostile to religion. Religion is an extraordinarily, incredibly broad, comprehensive phenomenon. Much of it is obviously superstitious in its political manifestations, especially these days, on the, in terms of conservative religionists, I think extremely dangerous and harmful. But I think that religion asks the right questions. I've always been fascinated by the nature of existence, the nature of being, the nature of highest values, and the religions have tried to address those issues. And I've always found those questions to be absolutely fascinating, even if I don't agree with the answers that the traditional religions create. It's very interesting. Felix Adler, you can say two things. When I look at Adler, he basically said, we have to be guided by the future. In other words, we have to have visions of the idea, what the ideals present for us with regard to an improved future, so that we ought to be pulled by the future more than pushed by the past. And like many contemporary ethical cultures, he was very critical of the historical religions and the claims they made. He thought they were old-fashioned. He thought that science had done away with them, even as he retained a type of religious sensibility of his own. And what's interesting, for someone who felt that we need to be inspired by the ideals of the future, he spent a lot of time doing academic research on the past. I mean, he was invested in traditional philosophers, Immanuel Kant most of all, but he's written wrote scores of technical papers on Aristotle. And what was odd about Adler, and I discovered this working in the Columbia archives, he wrote scores of papers on the medieval church. I mean, this is something that, you would wonder why was this dude interested in that? So in effect, he was an intellectual. He was an academic in many ways. He looked to the future with regard to social change and ethical culture and the type of society we need to struggle to build. And yet he was by no means an anti-intellectual. He thought that the past had something to teach us, and it would have been basically anti-intellectual and totally inappropriate to simply turn your back on past experience. So, what can I say? I mean, he looked both forward primarily, but also looked forward from an informed knowledge base, an informed commitment to understanding past traditions and how they created the present and what they had to say about the future. I mean, if you look at Rita's magnum opus again, An Ethical Philosophy of Life, he has chapters on the contributions of Christianity and Judaism to the world and his own thinking, ways in which he thinks modern thought has superseded those beliefs, but nevertheless elements in those traditions that are worth maintaining respect and reverence for. So, you know, it's to answer your question, it's a mix. Okay. And I agree with that. I mean, I'm not an anti-intellectual. I think anyone who, in effect, basically says the past has nothing to teach us, we live in the present and we live for the future, is a position that I temperamentally can't hold. I have too much reverence for the past and past thinkers and the wisdom coming from the past and ways in which they can inform our current understanding of the world and what they can give us as we think about our future. So, you know, everybody's going to be different temperamentally on how they look at that. And Adler looked both ways, primarily, though, putting emphasis on the inspirational value of looking ahead rather than looking back.
We have a couple of more questions.
Okay, you're welcome.
It's David and then Richard. David, why don't you go ahead and unmute?
Oh, yeah, you mentioned the role of Joseph Blau with that Humanist Manifesto. It's interesting. Joseph Blau wrote actually a very excellent history of American philosophy, which I've read several times, reviewing the thinking of philosophers throughout the American philosophical tradition.
Wasn't he a professor at Columbia?
Yes, I was his. I was his last student at Columbia before he officially retired. I had a tutorial with Joe Blau. I admired him. He was a professor of philosophy at Columbia. He was also Howard Radist. Howard Radist was our director of the American Ethical Union and the head of the schools. He was Howard Radist's history teacher in Rockaway. Howard was a student of his, which is an interesting trivia point to trivia. But Joe Blau was a marvelous man. There were two areas of interest. One was American philosophy. He was more a historian of philosophy than he was a technical philosopher. He knew more about these secondary 19th century figures, philosophical figures, than anybody. He wrote this book on philosophy, but he was also a student of Reform Judaism. His father was, like Felix Adler, he was the only other leader whose father was a Reform rabbi. And Joe Blau was a student and academic who wrote the first books on the history in the United States, the history of Reform Judaism. And he wrote several books on Reform Judaism as well as on American philosophy. So he had several major points of contribution, but it was not the Humanist Manifesto. He was responsible for sort of writing this piece, in very good one, it's several pages, two or three pages, on ethical culture as a humanist movement. It was 1965 or 66. The Humanist Manifesto was much earlier. It was 1933.
Right. Yeah, right. It was 25 years
later. You mentioned
later.
That. Right. Yeah, right. It was later. Right.
David, anything?
Yeah, two other brief comments. The actual, in a certain sense, the origin of American pragmatism is often attributed to Charles Sanders Peirce.
Right, yes.
And Peirce was an idealist. a form of post-Kantian idealism. And there's a strong idealist strain that runs through the pragmatic naturalism. The home of naturalism was Columbia University, and it was Woodbridge who had a profound influence on Dewey. He was there, of course, when Adler was there, as well as when Dewey was there. It's interesting the way in which the idealism of James and of Dewey, it becomes naturalized in interesting ways.
Well, I think that's
By the way, is. Did John Herman Randall have any role in the ethical movement?
Yes. He never joined the ethical movement. I knew John Herman Randall. He was an eminent historian of philosophy at Columbia. He was close to ethical culture. He was a colleague of Horace Freese, who was a distinguished professor of philosophy at Columbia and Felix Adler's son-in-law and a part-time leader of the New York Society in the 50s and 60s and early 70s. And he was a good friend of John Herman Randall. And I remember Randall speaking at the Ethical Society Society in the 1970s. Yeah, Columbia produced a lot of these great luminaries, historians of philosophy and philosophers. I think, Richard, what I'd like to do, if I can just take the stage for a minute, I have some books that people might be interested in. This is, Richard mentioned this, this was Dewey's little book on religion, where he lays out a humanistic religious orientation called A Common Faith. I should say Dewey, as mentioned, is very difficult to read. It's a turgid writer, turgid speaker, but this book is more accessible than most. And in it, he makes a differentiation between religion as a noun and religious as an adjective, advocating for a religious attitude towards life. It's a good read, and so on. Another book that I have is, there was a Dewey revival about 20 years ago, and I got all these books to read. John Dewey and American Democracy by a fellow by the name of Robert Westbrook. And this looks primarily, big book, looks at Dewey's political contributions and really interprets Dewey as much more radical in his politics than usually construed. And he makes an interesting point. I'm a child of the 60s, that the Port Huron Statement, which was created by Tom Hayden and others that founded SDS, Students for a Democratic Society, in the 60s, borrowed, he believes, very generously from Dewey's thought. They took Dewey very seriously. And this involves Dewey's political work.
It's really much more than that, Joe. I mean, Don't underestimate. It's much more than just a discussion of his political thought.
Oh, this book? Oh, yes, absolutely.
Discussions of experience and nature.
Absolutely.
Of experience.
Yes.
It sees the political as a thematic strand. But
right.
Westbrook's analysis right. is quite brilliant.
And it's a brilliant. Book. This is an, yes,
the
I
best
agree.
Book on Dewey that said that's out there.
You think it's the best? Okay. Well, there are others.
Well, we have an interesting right. question that's right. coming. I know Rich has had his okay. hand up, but
I'm sorry. Yeah.
We have an interesting question from Neil, and he asks, is the ethical culture school guided mainly by John Dewey's educational theories and methods? Anybody have a, do you have a thought on that, Joe? I know.
Well, Bob Burson, who taught at Fieldston for many years, may have some thinking about that and where the ethical school's pedagogy comes from and whether there's any Deweyan tie-in. Bob would be the most qualified person to talk about that.
Adler is known for his educational theories.
Yeah,
he
right.
developed the progressive concepts of education.
Right, early on, yes.
Formed
right.
this school, like one of the first things the Ethical Culture
right.
Society did. Bob, do you want to say something about that? Unmute if you do.
I think that given the time, the only thing that I would say is that both as a student and a teacher at Fieldston, there was a lot of hands-on experiential learning. And there was also a great deal of respect for the students and their own thinking. But that's really where I want to stop for this evening.
Right. Okay. What's interesting, let me just mention this in terms of tie-ins. Dewey established an experimental school in Chicago called the Laboratory School, where his pedagogy was put into practice. It's still there. And what I think is very interesting is Obama, Michelle, and Barack sent their two daughters, okay, to the Laboratory School. And I suspect it's still, in effect, committed to Dewey's pedagogy. So there's an interesting trivial fact there. I just wanted to show two more books, if I can, briefly for people who are interested. The most comprehensive is this book written by an Englishman who gets it right. It's called John Dewey and the High Tide of American Liberalism by an Alan Ryan. Also an excellent book. It's very comprehensive, looking at Dewey from different angles. But the one that is closest to our philosophy is, this is really a doorstop. It's called John Dewey, Religious Faith and Democratic Humanism. And it mentions ethical culture in many places throughout this book. It's written by Stephen Rockefeller, who is a professor of religion. He's from the Rockefeller family. And if you come from a wealthy family, you can afford spending your career teaching religion. He taught at Middlebury College. I met him on a few occasions at Middlebury College in Vermont. And it sees Dewey as a humanist. But I mention this because I wanted to pick up on what David Sprinson said. He sort of, Dewey started his philosophical interests as a Hegelian idealist. Hegel has an idealistic comprehensive view of reality. And Rockefeller interprets Dewey's naturalism with a type of idealistic cast. There's a type of religious quality to it, which he says really was informed by Dewey's earlier Hegelian idealism. So I'm just trying to confirm David's view that there is a type of twinge of idealism even in the naturalism of John Dewey. It's not a hardcore materialist like a Marxist materialist would be, in effect. There is an idealistic cast to Dewey's comprehensive
humanism.
Okay,
we have room for one more question. Rich has been very patient there with his hand up. So go ahead, Rich, unmute.
I want to share a story that I understand, Joe, that Professor Blau retired because you were his last student.
No, I don't think so. We actually had a pretty good, I think he liked me. I didn't offend him. I was nice to him.
But my question is, what is it about humanism that Adler was so adamant against?
Okay. I can answer that question. Adler was an idealist, and he felt that ideals had to be the origin and source of our ethics. And he felt that naturalism or humanism or Dewey's philosophy was simply not adequate. In effect, humanism in some ways was too self-referencing in terms of human beings, that you had to look above and beyond to the world of ideals to basically find where ethics resides. It does not reside in human experience, which is too protean, too mutable, always changing and unstable, whereas ideals are, again, timeless, eternal, and absolute. And that's where our ethical values have to come from. There's something very self-referencing about humanism. It looks too much at the human experience to guide how we ought to behave, whereas ideals that are basically transcend the world of nature, okay, and exist in the empyrean, impersonal as they are, have to be the source of ethics. So that in part was, I think, his thinking. Humanism, again, was rooted too much in the mutable, changing, imperfect human experience to give us what we need in terms of ethical guidance.
Yeah, okay. Bob has.
I would just like to go back to the point that Maria made very early on this evening, the sense that people need something spiritual, and recommend the short book that Joe mentioned, A Common Faith, because I think that's a way of getting into some of these questions, and especially the question of what we mean by spiritual and what we are looking for in that broad context. So Maria, I think it was a good question, and I would recommend Our Common Faith very strongly.
Any other questions as we are winding down? So we have two other meetings in this series. The next one, I'm forgetting, I think we were talking about the social action history of ethnic culture at the next one. And a lot of that is the history of the early years, because it is really an interesting, vibrant history. And a lot of the early legends about ethnic culture emerge around that history. So that's a lot of fun. I invite you all to join with us then. And the last one, I think we were going to try to gather together all the myths and crazy people and interesting people that have come through ethical culture.
We can do some name dropping.
A little name dropping, right. As a teaser, we'll talk about Albert Einstein. Okay. So thanks, everybody. It was really lovely being with everybody, and look forward to seeing you next month. And anytime coming by the New York Society or the Long Island Society in Garden City, which has also program every Sunday at 11 o'clock. And there's also a really wonderful community of nice folks. So bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.